to this with prayer tonight? Did I ask you last time? I think I did it last time. I want to...
11:14 or 12:18?
Good evening, and thank you, and welcome to the Bunnell City Commission meeting. It is Tuesday, May the 29th, 2018. It is approximately 7:20. If you would stand and salute the flag with me, please.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Roll call. Commissioner Tucker?
Here.
Commissioner Baxley?
Here.
Vice Mayor Rogers?
Here.
Commissioner Soul?
Here.
We have Ms. Boss here tonight. Welcome, and thank you for being here.
Thank you.
And our interim city manager, Tom, thank you for the job you're doing. City clerk, members of the public, and staff, thank you for being at the meeting tonight. We always like to open our meeting with a word of prayer. We want to remember the first responders, those who are in training to go all over the world to fight and defend our servicemen, our first responders, firemen, police officers. It's especially interesting and important to me that we had Memorial Day yesterday and the services to honor those who have departed, defending the rights for us to be able to have this meeting tonight. The service at Flagler County Courthouse was, Governmental Services Building was very meaningful and very important to remember our patriotic duty, to remember those who have given all. We also appreciated the fact that Mr. Mercer was honored yesterday. He's 92 years old and has been such an important part of our community over the many years that he's been here and served. And so I appreciated the fact that they did honor him yesterday. And yes, he's still alive. They didn't honor him for him being dead. I want to clarify that. Very much alive. Want to remember our servicemen all over the world, those who are fighting to defend our freedoms, those who will come home, those who will come home impaired, and those who will not come home. Want to remember the families of the servicemen and women who are, stay behind and do what they do every day to uphold their end of the bargain, something they probably didn't sign up for, but they're willing to do. Want to remember our president as he travels all over the world. We pray for wisdom and safety on his behalf and all those who travel with him. We pray for Congress, the Senate, our state level, and our local level as well. A lot to be thankful, a lot to be grateful for, and we don't want to take any of that for granted. Vice Mayor Rogers has agreed to open us with prayer tonight, so thank you.
Thank you, ladies and gentlemen, for coming this evening. If you would bow your heads with me. Heavenly Father, we thank you, God, for this night, God, and we thank you, Lord, for the men and women that serve this great nation in our armed services, Father. Lord, we pray a hedge of protection around them as they travel around the world for freedom, God. Lord God, we want to remember the ones that paid the ultimate price and laid down their lives for this great nation, God, and their family members that they left behind. Father, we ask you, Lord, just to be with them and comfort them, Father, and be with our president, God, as he travels the world, God, and we just pray for peace all over this world, God. And we ask you, Lord, to give our congressmen, our senators, God, our House of Representatives wisdom, God, as they're making decisions that change our lives, Lord God. And Father, we just pray for our local and state leaders here, our leaders in Flagler County. We pray for our law enforcement that risk their lives daily, God. We pray, Father, for them and our fire rescue personnel, Lord, our first responders, God. We pray a hedge of protection over them, God, and we pray that they'll make it home to their families, Father. And we thank you for this great city, Lord, and just give every board member up here wisdom, God, and put away their personal things, God, and just do what's best in the benefit for the citizens of Bunnell. We thank you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Thank you. So as we start our meeting, we have a proclamation. Is there someone here to accept the proclamation for the Motorcycle Awareness Month? Anyone here for them? No? We'll read it anyway. All right. Whereas motorcycle riding is a popular form of efficient transportation and recreation for more than 750,000 people in Florida, and whereas it is important that the drivers of all vehicles be aware of one another and learn to share the road and practice courtesy, and whereas motorcycles provide a means of transportation that uses fuel resources, causes less wear and tear on public roadways, and increases available parking areas, and whereas the safety hazards created by automobile operators who have not been educated to watch for motorcyclists on the streets and highways of Florida are of a prime concern to motorcyclists, and whereas it is especially important that the citizens of Florida be aware of motorcycles on the streets and highways and recognize the importance of motorcycle safety, and whereas the American Bikers Aim Toward Education of Florida Vintage Chapter representing St. Johns County, Flagler County, the City of St. Augustine, St. Augustine Beach, the City of Bunnell, the City of Palm Coast, and the City of Flagler Beach is an organization that is actively promoting the safe operation, increased rider training, and increased motorist awareness of motorcycles. And whereas it is important to recognize the need for awareness on the part of all drivers, especially with regard to sharing the road with motorcycles, and to honor motorcyclists' many contributions to the communities in which they live and ride. Now, therefore, I, Catherine D. Robinson, by the virtue of the authority vested in me as the mayor of the City of Bunnell, Florida, do hereby proclaim the month of May 2018 as Motorcycle Awareness Month, adopted this 29th day of May 2018. And I've thought numerous times, how would I feel if I was the one that ran over a motorcycle and I killed them? How would I live with myself, whether it's my fault or not? The death of someone and the life of someone is an important component to think about when you see motorcyclists and even bicyclists on the road. So just my little 2 cents tonight. Thank you for that. We have a presentation for information on mobile dating collectors for remote utility meter reading. Hi, Stella.
Good evening again. As you know, this year we've been going through the process, a project of changing out all of our meters to the remote read meters. The original plan was to actually install towers to do that remote reading. Recently, our meter provider vendor, SunState, has come to us with a different option. It's called mobile data collectors. And Mr. Kimbrough is here from SunState, so I'd like to get him to come up and describe that product to you, because it'll save significant money for the city.
Well, thank you. Good evening.
Good evening, Madam Mayor, fellow commissioners. I was here several months ago. My name's Jeff Kimbrough with SunState Meter and Supply. We've been doing business here well over 30 years with City of Bunnell, and we appreciate your business. I was before you several months ago. I hope most of you remember me not too long ago. And we talked about the products and the technology, and one of the things that was covered was the need to not only accurately measure the water here, so we're billing everybody properly and equitably, but also to speed up this process to make it more efficient at City Hall so we can turn the bills out and get the cash flow of the city. The water meters have the ability to do that, and that system is in. I want to give kudos to Stella, everybody, Michael, everybody, Utilities Department. Billy Baker is one of your field guys. He's not here tonight, but kudos, because most cities can't do that in-house. Most cities have to contract that out, and you folks did it in-house, and that's something to be proud of, especially a city your size. So all of those are in now. I think there's just a few left that they're working on right now. Now the question comes up, how are we going to collect that data and make it more efficient? You had a base system that we sold you that had some software and some handheld devices that basically still required a utility worker, multiple utility workers sometimes, to walk through the city and collect that data. Now that we have these automated radio frequency meters in, we have two different options. One is to put a tower-based infrastructure in. Stella's going to get on the costs that are associated with that. That's probably the high end of everything. There's considerable cost in installing those collector, purchasing those, and having them installed. To get the coverage we needed at this city, we would have to have one at the water tank and have it installed there. Plus, we'd have to have one at Public Works and one up State 100 east, to get full coverage. But both of those collectors would have required 80-foot towers to be purchased and erected to do those. Now, when it would come time to read water meters, those would do it very quickly, a matter of just a few minutes, all the readings would come in, but there's a cost associated with that. As the system installation has come to conclusion, we had another option that I wanted to present to the city. I came here several weeks ago, presented at Stella and Utilities, and it's our mobile data collector. And I think you probably have that cost quote in your packet. That unit is a very, very efficient way to read these meters. It's a portable unit. It's about the size of this folder, but it's about 4 inches thick. Very lightweight, can be moved to any vehicle. There's a mag-mounted antenna that goes on top of any vehicle, and it just plugs into your 12-volt power source. When you plug that unit in, it connects to a small laptop computer. They typically should be able to download all the routes within the city, and within 1.5 to 2 hours, as long as they can drive through the city at rated speed limits, they're going to be able to collect all that data and bring it back to City Hall for a cost that is drastically lower than putting the tower read system in. And so as we kicked about the benefits, the pros and the cons of that versus the expense of putting the towers in and the liability sometimes during our summer storms here, we can't cover act of God and things like that. If you had a lightning strike on your water tower and it just wiped out that data collector, it's going to be an emergency $10,000 expense to get that data collector replaced. So this unit's just going to be put in a vehicle for several hours each month, read, taken out of the vehicle, locked back up here at City Hall, read it all in 2 hours. And my advice to the city is that is the way to move forward for you. I think it's the most efficient way for somebody your size to move forward and then really enhance your meter reading operation. Do you have any questions?
Anyone have any questions?
Barbara.
Commissioner Baxley?
Yeah. Only down the road expansion, can you use two different ones and two different cars to do one half side, the other half?
Absolutely, you could. And the second thing, the meters and the products you've put in and the way you have installed them, let's say 5 years down the road, you say, you know what, we've got a lot of growth. We're going up US 1, you had a big developer. Mm-hmm. I'm just thinking outside the box. You could require them to put data collectors up there as part of their land development code. So you can use this type as a hybrid type system. So simply because you're making, if you do elect to move forward with this mobile collector, it's not telling you you can't go back to the towers at some other future point. You can always go to that enhanced kind of data capture down the road, so you're not obsoleting yourself out of that technology. Okay.
So I'm assuming that Stella's going to talk about the cost differences.
She is the money lady.
Yes.
Okay.
Well, actually, Mayor, towards the end of your agenda, there is an item to actually purchase some of the mobile data collectors. So would we want to wait till that point to talk about it? Or?
Well, I just thought since it was currently being discussed that there might be someone out there that was curious.
Okay. Well, the towers and related software were going to cost us in excess of $160,000. The quote for two data collector units, which would be a backup, you know, one unit would do it in several hours, like Mr. Kimbrough said, and we would have a backup second unit, is $47,400. He said it could be mounted in the vehicle. I'm sorry.
That's okay. The numbers are striking.
You got me out of order here.
Sorry.
Actually, the cost is $19,600. So it was a significant savings over the $160,000 that we have to do the towers.
Wow.
Yeah.
All right. So this is not an action item yet. This is just the presentation. So thank you for that. All right, we have impact fee study update. Good evening.
Good evening, commissioners. My name is Jonathan Paul. I'm the principal of New Urban Concepts. And tonight we're going to just present an overview of the impact fees. not actually asking you to take any formal action this evening. This is really more or less just for your information and to give you an update of where we're at in the process. As myself, I've been doing this for over 20 years now, and I do work all across the state of Florida, University of Florida grad, and this is something that's options as the economy continues to grow and there's needs placed on the community to accommodate new development. More and more local governments are considering either reinstating impact fees or going to what's known as a mobility fee. Just for the members of the public and for any of the board members that may not know, an impact fee is a charge on new development only. It's not assessed to any existing resident, any existing business. It's not a tax. It's actually a fee on new development to help offset their cost for new roadway improvements. And any type of fee within the state of Florida is required to meet what's known as a dual rational nexus test. First thing is you actually have to demonstrate there's a need for a fee, and most likely that's through the growth in your community. And then secondly, that there's a benefit of any private development that pays a fee. They actually receive something from it, whether they pay for a park, pay for a police vehicle, pay for a new roadway, they actually receive some type of improvement. And then finally, the legislature requires that any fee is related to the impact of that new development and that they can't be charged for more than their impact. The first requirement is to meet a need. And most likely in most communities, that's actually determined based on growth. And growth, we look at several factors. Some communities have the ability to go out and do projections of their population. Others rely on data that's already been collected and available. The University of Florida Bureau of Economic Business and Research publishes data annually to make projections on growth. Flagler County is one of the highest growth communities in the state of Florida, and you've got a couple of different options. Most local governments end up using the medium projections, and for Flagler County that means the population would increase from 103,000 to 167,000. Now what Beaver doesn't do is they don't break that down to the individual city level. So they don't go to Palm Coast or Bunnell or Gainesville and say, what's the city going to grow at? So we use similar projections. And based on those similar projections, it's a potential that the city of Bunnell's population could grow anywhere from 2,700, which it is currently today, upwards to 4,500 using the median projections, and as high as 5,500 if you use the overall high projections, and if the Flagler County continued to grow at the rate it has over the last 10 years. What does this mean in reality? Well, your comprehensive plan has standards for parks, and one of the impact fees being considered is a park impact fee. And your comprehensive plan states that there's 1 acre provided in the community for each 1,000 residents. Community parks, which have ballparks, fields, a little bit types of different types of amenities, are 3 acres per 1,000. And then your more conservation, larger scale recreation parks, which are 30 acres per 1,000. So what that means is, depending on whether you use the medium projection or the high projection, you could need anywhere between 1.7 acres to 2.8 acres of neighborhood parks in the future. Likewise, you have some potentials for 5 acres up to 8.5 acres for community parks. And what this means, if you use the higher growth number, in essence, there's a potential for your fee to be higher because they're paying for a higher overall number and a higher overall need to meet those level of service standards. For law enforcement, it's a little different. You don't actually have a standard in your comprehensive plan. So when that happens, most local governments defer to what are you currently providing in terms of your standards. And right now, I believe you have 9 officers and 1 chief. So it's essentially 10 officers for those 2,700 residents, or roughly 1 officer per every 300 people. Now again, this is just what it is today. This isn't something that's necessarily adopted into your comprehensive plan. So what that could mean is in the future, you'd have a need up to 6 additional officers. Each one of those officers is going to need equipment. They're going to need a vehicle. They're going to actually need a space to reside in. All those factors get included into the fee calculation itself. Now, some other local governments have actually elected to adopt a standard like you did for parks. So you could say, well, we're going to have a standard of 3 officers for every 1,000 residents. Absent some type of standard in your comprehensive plan, we're going to use whatever is the existing provisions today. So that'd be roughly 1 officer per 300 people. The fee itself is based upon the equipment in the buildings needed to house those officers. So each one of those officers is going to generate the need for additional vehicle, additional communication equipment, and also a different additional place. Those would all get factored into the fee calculation itself. The benefit side of the legislature is to basically say that anybody that pays gets something back out of it. And so for most local governments, especially cities, they elect to use their city boundaries as a limit. So basically, development anywhere within the city that pays a fee, those funds could be used anywhere within the community. The city of Bunnell is a little different because you actually, land-wise, are the second largest community in all the state of Florida. So it's something that, you know, we probably need to look at a little bit differently. I recently just completed the update of the City of Palm Coast transportation impact fee, and their benefit district is the entire City of Palm Coast. So wherever development is within the city that pays a fee, the city can then use that to program annually where improvements are made. With the city itself giving its size, there may be some opportunities to look at other areas. The other opportunity is to actually put in your ordinance that you say you have a new development that comes in and they're on a roadway that needs to be upgraded. You could actually make an agreement to say, if you upgrade that roadway for us, we'll reimburse you whatever fees you owe. And then depending on the type or the size of improvement, we could actually draw a boundary around your development to say anybody that comes in here that pays that fee will reimburse you because there's a benefit to the community of getting infrastructure up front. So, you know, that way you're not holding the one developer to pay for everybody. So it is something that the City of Palm Coast has done, and a lot of communities are starting to do it. They basically call it the ability to establish a development district or a front-ending agreement. And both of those are basically partnerships. If you had a very large subdivision came in and then they actually did multiple improvements, the city could always say, look, we'll reimburse you from future collections for those types of improvements. So you have some flexibility, and all these options will be provided to you in an improving ordinance. But there is some flexibility in terms of working with developers and getting some of the infrastructure up front. At the end of the discussion, there'll be a whole detailed technical report that goes into all the various factors. Essentially, this is how the calculation is in terms of determining roadways impact fees. So basically, it's based on new trip generation. Every use generates some type of trips. Those trips travel so far in the roadway network. The further they travel, the more trips they generate, the higher the fee. One option you do have available, the City of Palm Coast elected not to go that route, but I've worked in other communities that have of similar size, one being Dade City in Pasco County. And what they have wanted to have the opportunity to do is to also have the fee be spent on either a bike lane or a sidewalk connection. They were big on golf carts in their downtown, so they wanted the ability to provide a golf cart path. So there is an option early on, if we do it now, to structure the fee that it could be used to pay for other multimodal expenses, or it could be used just to pay for roadways. And that's really a decision that, if there is some guidance you can provide on that this evening, or if you'd like me to discuss it further, I could, but it is something that is an option available to you. And one reason that is appealing is actually the state of Florida is spending $25 million a year to expand the trail network. There's the coast-to-coast connector going from Brevard County all the way to St. Petersburg, and then there's also the river-to-sea loop going up between Daytona, along the coast, coming along the St. John's River, going back through DeBary. And so there was some discussion within Palm Coast, and there's been some discussion elsewhere, about the ability to maybe put a trail along State Road 100 that would essentially connect the river itself with the coast. If you had a multimodal fee, you could use some of that money to offer it as an incentive to the state to make those considerations. You have a roadway impact fee today. I believe it's currently a moratorium on it. It was updated back, I believe, in 2003 or 2007, so it's a number of years old. The number of land uses that it captures is quite detailed. So one of the things that we've looked at is to actually simplify it. So I think right now you have four or five different office categories and medical and dental, different sizes. You have a bunch of different retail uses, residential. Really want to try to simplify it. So if you're a residential unit, you would actually pay it. Right now it's structured that you pay per unit. So it doesn't matter whether you're 500 square foot, a tiny home, or 3,000 square foot, you pay the exact same rate, or you would if the fee was in effect. This schedule actually bases it on the square footage. So if you're a smaller unit, or a tiny home, or some of the other movements going towards smaller units, you would actually pay less of a fee. And then if you have the means to build a larger home, 2,500, 3,000 square foot, you would pay on that square footage. Likewise with office, the intent is to streamline it. So if you're medical, dental, financial, anything, any office is good office. It brings employment opportunities. So they would actually pay the same uniform rate. The same with retail and restaurants. And the only difference with retail is some of the uses that are a little bit higher, such as a bank with a drive-through or a fast food, McDonald's or Wendy's that has a drive-through generates more traffic than, say, a mom-and-pop restaurant, they would pay a little bit higher of a rate. And so that's what this proposed schedule is. I think right now the current schedule is three pages. This would essentially fit on a single page. This is the an excerpt, the City of Palm Coast elected to go with more detail. I believe it's actually 2.5 pages. And this just shows some of the residential and retail uses. This is sort of the number that we're going to look at and understand that, for economic reasons, and the City of Palm Coast has a little bit more of a demand, that, the intent would be to stay under these type of numbers. And I believe that most of the improvements you need in your community would result in fees that are lower than the City of Palm Coast. That kind of just gives you an idea of what the city did, and one unique thing that they did, and I want to discuss a little bit with you, is the old ITT platted lots back from the 1970s that make up a large portion of the historic part of Palm Coast. They actually elected to do a lower fee to encourage people to develop those as opposed to somewhere on the periphery. And so the fee actually reflects a lower dollar amount, and they call them vested duplex or vested single family. And so bringing that kind of same thought along, one option I wanted to present to you is you have the option of creating a downtown assessment area. So say somebody does move into a business here or puts a home within this area or within your current CRA limits or within roughly a mile of the historic core of the city, they would actually pay a lower fee because most of the people that live and work here aren't driving as much. They're not using as much as the infrastructure system. Whereas if you had a new subdivision out on State Road 100 or further out from the downtown core, they would actually pay a higher fee. So you don't have to do that, but it is one option you have if you wanted to, say, encourage or not charge as high a fee within your downtown core. And these are just several options. The CRA boundary already exists, it already is adopted. You could use that as a limit. You could also say within a certain area of your downtown area. One of the things I mentioned is there is a push, a strong push, even though most of the retailers out there are shrinking their footprint a little bit because of Amazon and e-commerce deliveries, there's also a push in the opposite direction to encourage people to drive to uses. And so the fee itself reflects the gas stations or a bank drive-through or drive-through lane on a fast food versus somebody that wants to do something that you walk up to. So it does charge a little bit higher of a fee. And actually, I saw for the first time in the state of Florida, over in Interlochen, there was actually a Dollar General with a gas station. So, you know, land uses are, you know, they're starting to evolve, they're starting to change, and, you know, it was already a higher trip generator beforehand. It's even more so when you add a gas station to it. So that concludes my presentation this evening. Again, this is more of an informational item. The next time that you'd see me would actually be a technical report that would lay out all the options for the fee and then a broader discussion. So I'm here to answer any questions that you may have and provide any guidance. Once this is done this evening, we'll be moving back fairly quickly. I think sometime the end of summer, the early part of fall, we'd actually bring back a technical report for your consideration.
Do you have any questions from the board? Any comments from the public? Come forward, sir, and state your name.
Thank you. Bob Porter with DR. I just want to encourage you. I know you're not to the point of voting on impact fees tonight, but I want to encourage you to keep in mind that, you know, we're selling homes, of course, out at the project that you'll be taking up in a little while. The biggest complaint that we get from customers is that it costs more to live in Bunnell than it does in Palm Coast, because it's 3.2 mils higher here than it is there. So we're hearing that all the time. One of the advantages we have is we do not have the fee today with the moratorium that they have in Palm Coast. So we're able to offer a better value. So as you look at this, I just ask you to keep that in mind. We have closed 35 houses so far, and that should generate something like $50,000 a year to the city. By the time we're done, it'll be over $1.5 million a year. So I think it may be important for the city to consider trying to keep the fees down, and with the retail as well. You know, I think we all want to encourage more jobs. Raising fees doesn't help. If Palm Coast has higher fees, there's an incentive for people to come across the border into Bunnell right now. So just when you get to that point, please keep that in mind.
Thank you. Anyone else? Yeah.
Most likely to get the benefit out of everything, we'd schedule it as a workshop first before we drafted anything so that we can have the input once we have the technical report, so that we don't draft something that the commission does not want, period. So it would come as a workshop first to get the direction that needs to be done, and then draft what we need to be at the resolution or the ordinance in order to do what the commission would prefer.
Yep, that sounds like a good plan. All right, thank you, sir. I appreciate your time.
Thank you.
We are now at the consent agenda. We have C1, approval of the warrant for May 29th, 2018. C2, approval of minutes of the May 14th City Commission workshop minutes for the purchasing policy discussion. And that was A. B is May 14th City Commission meeting minutes. C3 is request approval of payment for the annual pipe and wire lease charges to Florida East Coast Railway Company. C4, request approval to purchase an irrigation pump for the wastewater treatment plant. C5 is request approval for the piggyback agreement amendment between Advanced Environmental Laboratories and the City of Bunnell. C6 is request approval to increase the Morton salt threshold, and C7 is to transfer funds and close the Center State Money Market account. So there are seven items on the consent agenda. Are there any items that the board would like to pull off for further discussion? Hearing none, what is the pleasure of the board?
Madam Mayor.
Vice Mayor Rogers.
Would you approve the consent agenda?
Have a motion to approve by Vice Mayor Rogers. Do I have a second?
Second.
Second by Commissioner Baxley. Discussion by the board. Hearing none, I close our discussion, open for public discussion. Seeing no one come forward, I close public discussion. All those in favor of the motion signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, the consent agenda is approved. It is now time for public comments. We welcome any comments or thoughts that you might have on any item that is not on the agenda. Please state your name and where you live, and if you have a suggestion for improvement, we like to hear that. If we're doing something right, we want to hear that as well. We run a civil meeting, and we appreciate the cooperation for that. Open it up. Good evening.
Good evening, Mayor. Gentlemen.
Your name?
My name is Marion Irvin. I am a citizen of Palm Coast, but I have a business with my husband here in Bunnell. What I'm coming to you about this evening is I am a member of the Order of Eastern Stars, which is a sister to the Masonic Order. We utilize the, I don't know if it's still called the City Hall, the Coquina building from the city. We utilized that building on the 20th of May. We did what we call, we did an annual tea, and we've done this before at the City Hall. What really disturbed me was when I came back, well, let me clarify a few things, first of all. I was with my two aunts, who one's 92 and one is in her late 70s. One had fallen, and we needed to get her to the hospital and this type of thing. So Friday, I failed to get the key and pay the fee. I called someone that apparently trusted me, and that person in turn called Stella, and I met with Stella. I got the key. We went into the City Hall on Sunday afternoon. That was the time of the tea. And the person I called is your mayor, okay? Because I've known her. Well, we've known each other pretty much all of our lives. To get to the point I'm trying to make is, when I came in, I came to the city on Monday to return the key as well as pay the usage fee. I was told and given a paper saying that we left the building in disarray, saying that we had not swept the floors, emptied the trash, or any of these things, and they were going to withhold $50 of our deposit, which they did have on record. And that just did not set well with me, because we never leave a place worse than what we go into it. We swept the floors, we emptied the trash, we did a few things more than was required of us. Now, I don't know where this report came from, but if you like, I have a copy of it here with me. I meant to bring it up, but I just jumped up to talk. I urge you all to look into what's going on here, because if people have cleaned that building, swept the floor, emptied the trash, and this type of thing, it needs to be looked into, because you're going to lose money. You're going to lose money because people will not trust the city of Bunnell if this type of thing continues to go on. It's not about the money for me. Because if I had to pay, because it's not my money, but if I have to pay my chapter back, the money that the city is withholding, they said it took the person 2 hours to clean the city hall. I don't think so. And they were going to withhold $50 of our deposit. I argued the point. They cut it back to 1 hour. If they need that $25 that bad, they can have it. I'll pay the chapter. But you all need to look into this, because it is not fair to people who trust to have their activities here in the city, to have that type of thing happen to them. My grandmother, my grandparents, the Goldens and the Irvins, we are not that type of people. We never take. The Order of Eastern Stars gives more to the city of Bunnell than the city of Bunnell is even aware of. We do things for the children. We do things for the families. We even help Habitat for Humanity. We don't ask for anything but to be treated fair. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Someone else? Good evening.
Good evening, Madam Mayor, Commissioners. Daisy Henry, for the record, I live at 503 East Drain Street in Bunnell. And Monday, I was going to complain about that corner where I had told you about the first meeting. But my daughter told me that the officers had run them off the corner of Anderson and Martin Luther King. That vacant lot is posted, but the officers are not, or were not, making them stay off the corner. It's like a mud puddle there. But now, on the other side, they park on the other side on that posted property. But my daughter told me Monday that the officer had ran them off. So now they are right across the street over there in a private property. Okay, today I just was riding on M Street where my church is. And I went around, I think it's Lincoln Street, whatever. And going in that dead end where the Andersons live at, it's like a junkyard up in there. I mean, cars everywhere. That part of the town has been abandoned. I mean, just about 7, 8, 10 cars by where Mac Jones and live at, down with the Anderson in the hole. It's just cars everywhere. Where Matthew Lee Williams used to live at, back up to where Frankie Wilson was living at. And even on the lot that Steve used to have, there's trash on that right off of the apartment complex. So we need to get our code enforcement guy over there. And like I said, when I had my little son's car backed up in my driveway waiting on the tag, and I had to move it years ago. So the same thing applies. And we need, it's another thing, I had to address a young fella about every day time I come out my door, I'm tired of seeing drugs. And he got kind of upset, but I went to him and told him I wouldn't go to the office. But like I told you, it's on my right hand, it's on my left hand. I'm tired of coming out of my door every day looking at drug sales. And it's just like, how you say, passing a piece of candy to the baby. They don't care about it. Don't have no respect. So you need to get your office on top of that, because a lot of people want to complain, but they're afraid. And I want to make sure that I got the number back that non-emergency, is it
4911.
Okay, I want to get that right, because I was going to pass that a number on so they could call unanimously. But thank you.
Thank you. Someone else? All right. Thank you very much. Appreciate those comments. We have no ordinances. We have a resolution, F1, Resolution 2018-05. Would you like to read the short title, please?
Yes. This is a resolution of the City of Bunnell, Florida, adopting a temporary moratorium on the enforcement of city code provisions as to food sales from food trucks and specifying parameters thereof, providing for the city's right to revoke at will, and specifying that no vested right, expectation, waiver, or estoppel shall arise, providing for conflict, severability, and an effective date.
Thank you very much.
It's me.
Kristen.
At the May 14th meeting, you added to the agenda an item to suspend the enforcement of the mobile food regulations on the food trucks. This is a follow-up to that. This is a resolution that was prepared by the city attorney to go ahead and make that official, putting a moratorium on the enforcement of those provisions for 90 days to allow the commission to provide directions to staff as to what regulations they do want, so they can go to the planning board, so then they come before the commission, because any regulations would go into the land development code, which takes planning board recommendation and then two readings to become effective and become a regulation. Again, so this is a follow-up to that. And then also on this agenda is the item to discuss, so that you can provide direction to staff so we know what to put in the ordinance that would go to the planning board.
Is 90 days going to be enough for all that?
Wade believes so.
Okay.
And if we need to come back and amend it, we can. If it's okay, we can come back and amend the resolution to give more time.
Okay. Thank you. So you've heard the short title to Resolution 2018-05. What's the pleasure of the board?
Madam Mayor.
Commissioner Tucker.
I would suggest that we place a moratorium on the on enforcing the ordinance as one motion, and then address the other separately.
It's a separate item. The discussion item, item G1, is the mobile food truck regulations for you to provide direction to staff. So this item, F1, is solely the resolution only.
Well, on my sheet, it says resolution adopting a temporary moratorium on the enforcement city code provisions as to food sales from food trucks and specifying parameters thereof. Are we talking about these things that you provided for us from different municipalities that suggest what they have, like Palatka, Orange County, or Orange, whatever?
Correct. That discussion is in G1, so that you'll have all those, you got all those recommended or
okay,
other
I see.
Ordinances.
All right. Okay.
So did I hear you make a motion?
Second.
Sure, I made the motion, so.
I just wanted to, I don't want to put words in
your
mouth.
Yeah, well, you know, it's just, it seems like we can put a temporary moratorium on the enforcement of the city code as to food sales from food trucks, period. Specification or specifying parameters thereof, you know, are you talking about the length or the, Kristen, are we talking about the, what the yes. parameters of the not enforcing the food truck ordinance is, or what exactly are you looking for? Because, you know, I would think that adopting a temporary moratorium on the enforcement of code provisions as to food truck sales from food trucks should be the motion.
And it's, well, and then it's also the temporary enforcement of the moratorium for the business tax receipt regulations for those food trucks who may set up to do those food sales from the roadside on private property, not on commercial properties, not on like public property or on right of way. So if they set up it like we have the one vendor who sets up on private property to sell that, they can continue to do that until we get our regulations in place at the direction of the commission. Again, we're having that discussion later tonight so we know what we can do so we can move as fast as we possibly can without impacting their sales, and they will continue to be able to do business like you had authorized on May 14th.
So this is just formalizing our action from May 14th.
Three words and specifying parameters thereof. So that's the motion.
So I have a motion to approve Resolution 2018-05 by Commissioner Tucker and a second by Vice Mayor Rogers. Discussion by the board? Hearing none, I close our discussion. Open for public discussion. Good evening.
Hey. I need our sign either 16, right? So we can continue to do sales. No repercussion or anything. We have 90 days for everything to get settled. And my question is, if it takes more than 90 days, it can be brought up to extend.
We will amend it, as she said, to
yes.
extend
it. If it takes us longer than the 90 days in the resolution, we'll come back to extend the moratorium so that we can continue. Hopefully it won't take us 90 days, but because you're talking two boards, you got to make sure you can get your advertisements in and be legal when we do something, otherwise when we have other problems.
Okay. Is there any way that I can put on that? I know it has to go to the development board for the plans and all that. We are at K&M Lawnmower. I know you have to zone where everything's going to be. We have their permission. We have the insurance. Is there any way that we can put on there that would be under consideration of where we can park so we don't have to start over again?
That's the next agenda item.
Okay.
Okay? All right.
Bye.
It's okay. Someone else? Seeing no one else come forward, I close public discussion, reopen for any board discussion. Hearing none, I call for the vote. All those in favor of the resolution 2018-05 signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Those opposed? The resolution passes. All right, we're now at G1, discussion of mobile food truck regulations. Kristen?
Back at the beginning of May, at the request of the commission, we gathered a bunch of adjacent jurisdictions or other jurisdictions who have actually gone through and adopted regulations on mobile food vendors. The trucks that park along or park on properties or along the sides of roads in order to do food sales. We did provide those to the commission for review, so you've had them for a little while. And at this point in time, staff is looking for direction from which of the ordinances you've been provided you like, which language you don't want us to incorporate. If there is one that you prefer over the other, minus changes to what they have, give us that direction. That way we can draft something to get before our planning board, and then eventually it will come before you for approval with a recommendation from the planning board. But this would be in our supplementary district, our supplementary zoning regulations specific to the food trucks, such as these other jurisdictions have adopted.
All right. So, comments from the board. What do you like?
Madam Mayor.
Commissioner Soule.
I like the Palatka ordinance. It's simple. We talked about things getting too complicated with our purchasing. When you look at some of these other ones, they get so complicated. It's just too much. And the Palatka is just short, sweet. The only thing I disagree with particularly is the right-of-way usage. I don't think that we should allow food trucks on right-of-ways for this ordinance. It's not necessary, and it could create a public safety issue as well.
Okay, I kind of like that too for the same reasons. It's pretty simple.
Madam Mayor.
Vice Mayor Rogers.
It is very simple. I like it too.
Commissioner Tucker.
Well, I would cross out a few things. On A, it says uses must be located on private property, except that in the downtown, across it out, everyday zone, every overlay zone, okay. We could cross that out, I believe. And we need to exclude St. John's Avenue frontage. That's, that's over there, not here. And I think that perhaps we had an issue with establishment being open till midnight on the 4th of July. Perhaps these folks, as it's stated in the Orange County, I think, that they allowed theirs from 7 a.m. to 12 o'clock a.m. So, I'm not going to be out at that hour anyway, but I'm sure people are. But it would give at least an option to stay open a little longer if you so desire. And then available parking required, I would X that whole H thing out of the ordinance. And I would delete the outdoor tables. I don't think we need to have that. I think it works out pretty good like it is. Walk up and walk away.
Going back to the A, it said food trucks must be at least 200 feet from a residential zone property. How far is 200 feet? Would that be a problem on US 1 to residential?
No. Okay. No, that you have a full block, and that's, you'll be fine, because the original lots of record were 50 frontage, 100 foot deep. So you have 200 feet from the residential outside.
Okay.
But remember also, railroad is actually commercial. So you extend, railroad is actually a commercial, it's commercially zoned properties for the most part.
Okay.
Then I would delete M, like I said, and maybe change the verbiage of the insurance requirements. I would put general liability, combined single limit, $1 million, as opposed to how it's stated in here. We could come up with a little better requirement for that. So that's what I would suggest. Those changes.
Thank you.
But Palatka was the one that I liked the best.
Other comments?
Madam Mayor.
Commissioner Baxley.
Yeah, I like the Palatka as well, but there was also some in the other two, Palm Beach Gardens and St. Pete's. There was a couple of three that I thought what we should basically, but just, one opinion, I thought basically what we should do is pick from the three the things that apply to Bunnell. Because you may find something in the Palm Beach Garden that you would like to have, and some in the St. Pete's as well that would fit into Bunnell, but a lot of them wouldn't, a lot of it wouldn't. and Palatka does, majority of that does fit into Bunnell.
So was there something in the St. Pete regulations that you wanted to add?
No, I was just reading, when I read all three of them, I just liked some of the things that was in the Palm Beach and the, but off my head, I didn't write them down. I should have, but I didn't. My bad.
Was, can you remember just the general type of regulation that you were thinking of when it came out of the Palm Beach one? What it may have entailed?
I don't remember now, but I'd have to read it back over again to find it. But if the majority's comfortable with Palatka, then I'm comfortable with it.
Well, maybe you could call Kristen with your thoughts.
Yeah, I can do that.
So.
Because we're going to modify it. I mean,
you'll be
we have an
to
opportunity
modify
to modify it if
correct
it's not something we're really thinking.
Correct. Like I said, the planning board will see it first because it does have to come to you with a recommendation from the planning board because it is a change to the land development code. But at first reading, if we didn't catch what you were thinking out of the Palm Beach one or we didn't make the right changes, at first reading you can approve it with these changes to include that, so that when it comes back to its second reading, then you are ready to go ahead and adopt it rather than having to delay and redo first reading at that point in time.
All right, any other comments by the board? Hearing none, I close our comments, open for public comments. Come on up. You had something to say, come on up and say it.
I just want to say thank you for...
Well, that's off the record, we can't hear you.
I just want to say thank you for working with us and rewriting and getting this to where it's feasible for the city of Bunnell, us as a family, and we do bring business and we've had people come back to see us and stuff, so I just want to say thank you.
Okay. Thank you. All right, any other public comments? Hearing none, I close public comments, reopen for any board comments. Hearing none, I call for the vote. This is not a vote.
No, this is not a vote. You're providing us direction so that we can draft an ordinance
okay
with your recommendations.
All right, so we're good with that.
We're good.
All right, new business, discussion on the Alert Florida system. Good evening.
Good evening. Jonathan Lord, Emergency Manager and Chief for the Flagler County.
Welcome.
Thank you. Thank you, Mayor and Commissioners. So speaking with Chief Foster, one of the things that I've been trying to do as I've been on board for the last 4 or 5 months here in Flagler County is to try to find projects that we can work on together as a county, as collectively, not just the counties, but also with the cities. Going back to 2016, in my prior job, I actually worked with the state of Florida, the Division of Emergency Management, State of Florida, and one of the projects we did up there was to do something similar at the state level, try to work with the counties better, and find ways to consolidate programs and pass on cost savings to the counties and municipalities. One of these was the Alert Florida program, which in 2014 and 15, we looked across the entire state and saw that a lot of counties, probably 58, 59 counties out of 67 counties, were all independently paying for different alert and notification systems. So systems to notify the public of needs to evacuate or shelter in place or other protective actions. And the costs were upwards of $10, $15, $20 million being spent statewide in aggregate. So we looked at it as a state and decided that if we procured it at the state level, we could do it for significantly less and provide access to all jurisdictions in the state, counties, and cities. So that was one of the projects when I went up there. Fast forward to back in January when I left the state to come here to wonderful Flagler County. I saw that Flagler County was actually one of the communities that was not yet participating in this system. So we started off with the county joining and participating in the system. The sheriff actually has run, sheriff's run off and done with, been quicker with than anybody else. The county, we're slowly working towards it. Wanted to make sure you have a good transition time with our current code red system, which you all participate in. But that we do pay $27,000 a year at the county level to maintain that system. So we are in the process of joining the Alert Florida system under the county board. So one of the recommendations we have for you all is, and for every municipality and county, is that you also join the system. And it's as simple as signing an agreement with the state of Florida. It's not between you and the county. It's between you all and the state. It allows you to access the system if you should ever need to do so. At this point in time, you know, I recommend the crawl before you run concept of going ahead and signing the agreement so that you can become part of the system. It does not mean you have to use it right away. Right now, with Code Red, you all refer your residents to the county's system. That would not change. It would just change names to, we're going to call it the Alert Flagler system. But in the future, should the city wish to utilize the system independently of the county, you'd already have the legal paperwork out of the way, and you all could come on board and use that same system. The system is primarily set up for emergency notifications, like I mentioned earlier, but one of the neat features that the statewide system allows is something called community engagement. So if you wanted to send out notices about parks or things like that, or events happening in the city, if residents chose to subscribe to those events, self-subscribe to those events, you could actually send a message out on behalf of the city to those who chose to receive those kinds of messages, which is something kind of unique that a lot of alert systems like the current Code Red one the county is using does not allow. It's restricted specifically to emergency messages only, but the vendor that the state contracted with is allowing the non-emergency use of that as long as people subscribe to those and not just calling them without a subscription.
What is the cost?
It costs to the city and the county absolutely nothing. The state of Florida is paying $3.5 million a year for unlimited use for all political subdivisions within the state of Florida, which includes all counties, cities, and certain special districts.
So will it replace the reverse 411 or the NIE?
The Code Red reverse 911?
Yeah.
Yes. So ultimately, my goal is to try to make the transition towards the end of hurricane season and not do a big change in the middle of hurricane season. However, the caveat with that is our current contract with Code Red runs out in September. I'm hoping they'll allow us to buy one more quarter to get us through hurricane season with a buffer. But if not, we have a plan in place to transition sooner.
Okay.
Don, you want to talk about, it's already posted on our website.
Don Moines, Deputy Clerk. Chief and I met with Jonathan last week sometime, and following that meeting, I had guidance from Chief to update all the web links on our website that were referring to Code Red directly to Flagler Alert, which is a, right now it's just a pass-through page that they have set up, but eventually it will be where they go to register for. And as I understand, Jonathan's hope is he's going to get the database from Code Red and dump it into the new system, so anybody who's already registered will be registered in the new system.
Our goal is to just transition those individuals over. Again, that's technically up to the existing vendor that lets us have that, but it is government-owned data that's residing in their system, and the contract in theory allows us to access that data and then re-upload it into a new system. We, as we move forward this year, we're about to reprint our disaster guides that we've actually recently about to run out of. And in there, we're just changing the name, the moniker, to Alert Flagler. We're making it generic, and it's not going to reflect the entity's name. The company that the state uses happens to be called Everbridge, but I don't believe in marketing on behalf of that company. The generic name the state's using is Alert Florida. We'll call it Alert Flagler. If Bunnell down the line decides you all want to start doing your own messaging, you could call it Alert Bunnell. But you know, since it's a procured service from the state could change vendors 2 years from now, and I wouldn't want to have to remarket everything again. So we're kind of sticking to that generic moniker, and then it gives our own governments some ownership in that product and service as well.
All right. Questions or comments from the board?
Madam Mayor.
Vice Mayor Rogers.
I recommend we go with it.
Well, it's not an idea. It's just discussion, so we're not voting.
Correct. Because there's a resolution that needs to go along with the MOU, we'll prepare a resolution that's the City of Bunnell's resolution format, which you have, are templates that were provided to us to show you what we would have to enter into, so we can bring this item back to you at the next meeting as a resolution in the resolution section, and then signing the MOU either in the consent section. If you guys feel this is, you know, you want to give us that direction, we can put that MOU in the consent or under a new discussion item, but we'll get them, we can get both carried over to the next meeting for official signature and action.
Okay. Any comments or questions by the board?
Madam Mayor.
Commissioner Sewell.
I think it's a great idea.
There you go. Anyone else?
Ditto.
I like the price.
Okay. All right, I close our comments, open for public comments. Seeing no one come forward, I close public comments. We're not going to vote on this, but we'll bring it back in ordinance form. Is it ordinance?
Resolution.
Or resolution form. Okay.
Thank you, Mayor and Commissioner.
Thank you. All right, H2, approval of D.R. Horton, Inc. and Deer Run CDD proposed PUD agreement for portions of the Grand Reserve subdivision. Good evening.
Good evening. Harper Mitchenberg, 1729 Ridgewood Avenue. I'm the design engineer on the project. I had the pleasure many years ago of doing the original Oak Branch design for a gentleman named George Lees.
Wow. That goes back a while.
I'm a lifelong resident of Volusia County and been in the engineering business for 34 years. So from there, we then came back probably 12, 14 years ago, and we permitted Grand Reserve and Deer Run. And the first phase of Grand Reserve and the golf course, as well as the main road and Deer Run infrastructure were completed. Then the recession came along and everybody got mothballed and put on hold. So now we're back with a one of the U.S.'s, in my opinion, largest builders with D.R. Horton. The gentlemen behind me here represent them and can answer questions. Kristen just put up the rendering here, but we're basically looking at the area you see on the rendering that is the kind of orange in color. In the original design, up here at the top was phase 4 and 5, and there were townhouses proposed. So what's being proposed by D.R. Horton is a rezoning to single-family housing. And for the combination of Grand Reserve and Deer Run, there's actually a reduction in the number of units from 931 to about 850. So we're excited about the project. D.R. Horton's excited about getting under construction, and I'm kind of here to answer any questions you guys might have.
And just to break it out a little bit further for those who probably weren't here back in 2005 through 8 when all of this started, this section here that's in the green that has some of these existing yellow in it is the original portion of Grand Reserve, the Grand Reserve project. Portions that are currently owned by the CDD and D.R. Horton that are in the orange or yellow color are the ones that are going to be affected by this new agreement. All the existing portions, the existing 157 lots that are over here, the golf course, and some of the existing open areas are not being affected by this proposed agreement. We're also adding in this portion, which was going to be Deer Run, went through a planning board review, never got before the commission for an actual approval for that PUD agreement to happen. So they are going to be adding this portion of the project into the Grand Reserve development that's being marked, you know, in the yellow and the purple areas. In addition to this, they're getting two neighborhood parks in the Grand Reserve area. There's one in this community here that's an open space area, and then there's also going to be one down here on this portion in what was Old Deer Run, but is off of Grand Reserve Boulevard. So two neighborhood parks are going to be built into this development in compliance with our comprehensive plan. So this is a great thing for the city, for D.R. Horton. City attorney and D.R. Horton and I, we've been working on this agreement to make sure that everything that we need that's in place is in place so that development can continue to go in this subdivision.
That's exciting. Especially like those two parks where all those people are going to move in there with all their children. Interesting. So where does this come out, this part on the right here?
Right over here? That's the East Media Boulevard gates.
Okay.
Right there next to the storage is right
okay.
here. Those are the big gates there, and then you have, you know, the Mathan
right.
complex here.
Wow. That's a lot of building.
Seven phases, and we got a plat coming right down the line right after this.
Well, I have to tell you, your flowers are very pretty at the entrances.
Well, thank you for that.
It's the little things, you know. My husband and I actually rode through the development and appreciated the flowers and went through the model homes, which I'd already done, but he hadn't. So that was a nice afternoon for us. All right, getting off track here. So, what's the pleasure of the board regarding approval of the D.R. Horton, Inc. and Deer Run CEDD proposed PUD agreement for portions of Grand Reserve subdivision?
Madam Mayor.
Commissioner Soul.
I move that we approve the D.R. Horton, Inc., Deer Run CEDD proposed PUD.
Have a motion to approve by Commissioner Soul, second by Vice Mayor Rogers. There's no concern with Commissioner Soul voting on this issue since he lives in the D.R. or the Grand Reserve.
There is no problem.
Just wanted to be sure and get it up front. Okay. Thank you. Comments by the board?
Madam Mayor.
Commissioner Soul.
Just a question for D.R. Horton. It's my understanding that this part of getting this done will enable you all to can proceed with your refinancing of the bond money. Is that correct?
Yes, sir. This is the last thing we need to get done.
It's the last thing that you need to do. And then what's your timeline for beginning construction on the amenity center?
We submitted the plans for the amenity center. The city asked us to add fire suppression, so we've taken it back. The engineer has done that. It will be resubmitted within the next couple of days. So it'll be in for final permit. We've got a contract already. We've got a general contractor in place for a little bit over $3 million for the amenity center. As soon as we get a permit, we'll be starting hopefully within the next 30 days.
Kristen?
We provided the site plan comment letter to your engineer in April. I've been in touch with him. He's going to resubmit for approval so we can get it on the planning board's agenda for approval. Because of the size of the project, it requires planning board approval. We've got a couple of projects for D.R. Horton going on simultaneously at this time. This is the first step that we're doing because we also have the replat for phase 1A and 1B also being considered and going on simultaneously right now. So this is 1A. This is 1B, another 125 single-family residence homes. One of those will be marketed as a 55-plus community that will be gated at this time, is what they're planning right now. So we've got a lot of projects going on for D.R. Horton. We're moving them along as fast as we can. This is one of the steps that we need to get done first so that they can continue to develop based upon what those projects are going to require. So right after we get this, you're actually going to see an ordinance that changes the zoning on this portion of the property to the PUD zoning because it still has its old zoning on it because the PUD was never done. So the planning board is reviewing that in June. So in July, you're going to see the ordinance that will change the zoning for these properties to the PUD zoning so that this agreement will be able to apply to those when they get ready to develop and do their platting for that as well.
Madam Mayor.
Commissioner Tucker.
Can we get the gentleman's name for the record?
Bob Porter. Yeah, I'm sorry. Bob Porter.
Okay. Thank
D.R.
you.
D.R. Horton, 4420 Racetrack Road, St. John's, Florida.
Thank you.
Thank you. My board keeps me straight. Any other comments by the board? Hearing none, I close our comments. Open for public comments. Seeing no one come forward, I close public comments. All those in favor of approval of this item on the agenda signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Those opposed, the motion carries.
Thank you.
See, H3, discussion on the fiscal year 2019 budget planning and calendar. Why am I not surprised?
Good evening again. Stella Gurney, Finance Director. It is that time again.
Yep.
That we need to go into our budget planning. So we've put together a calendar that keeps us in compliance with the state's truth and millage regulations. So the dates, you'll see some things in there that say this must be 65 to 80 days after this date. Those all keep us in line with that trim compliance so that we can pass that for the state. So this is the proposed calendar. Also wanted to, if we had any discussion or input that we could get from you, I know that all of you want options to look at, but if there's anything specific that you can tell us that you want to do. For instance, I know one commissioner wants to decrease our millage rate. So, you know, we'll be glad to provide a range of millage rates, several different rates. And also, if you want to perhaps give us some guidance on CPI increase for salaries, and then any other priorities that the commission might have. So any upfront guidance that you can give us to help us develop the budget. You know, there may be positions that you're looking for. I know we've talked about police officers and public safety being a big need. I've heard you talk recently a lot about economic development. Are you looking, you know, for something more in there, a position, a consultant, or whatever? So really just kind of open the floor up to talk about the budget planning calendar and anything that you can give us as far as guidance up front to try to work on to give you options to be able to make your decision-making easier.
Kristen.
Just to advise you that also currently set on July 23rd is the Administrative Services Department presentation. So in order to accommodate this schedule, we would either move that to possibly the July 9th meeting, or if you wanted to, and to, because you're having workshops almost every single night for the rest of the year, if you wanted to get that department presentation like you do the city manager report, and then we can discuss it if we needed to. It is entirely up to the commission, but we would move the Administrative Services Department presentation to a different day, or how you'd want to handle that one so we don't disrupt this budget planning.
One of the things that I want is to have the workshops not before a meeting, but in a different night than a meeting, so that we have plenty of time to discuss and look at the workshop and look at what's being presented. And I would like the budget to be sent to me in hard copy and not emailed me. And I would like it for more time than the Thursday before the Monday of the first workshop, so that there's time to go through it and look at it. I just need a little more time. I have grandchildren. I would like to see a community development director position looked at. That was a temporary position with Mick going into retirement, and with all this development that is coming and is at our doorstep, I think that we need to relook at that. Anyone else?
And you have, I just wanted to know if she has two commissioners that wants to reduce the millage rate.
Well, I think you probably have five commissioners that want to reduce the millage rate. The question is, can you perform that magic? That's the question. There's no one up here that wants to increase it.
The magic is you reduce revenue, something. You reduce expenses. That you know, we've had some growth, so we should have some gains.
Yep.
But got to keep the budget in balance. So
I agree. So that's what we're going to do. Any other thoughts?
Madam Mayor.
Vice Mayor Rogers.
I concur with what you just said. We need a hard copy, and we need some time to look at it, and we definitely don't want to do it before a city council meeting.
So we'll update this calendar to try to move the workshop. I'll work with Kristen, and we'll try to you know, if there's dates that are better for you that is around the workshop dates.
Is there a day of the week that we can plan on, and not the second Wednesday and not the third Tuesday, because that's code board and PZA board?
Well, don't we have a Monday that we don't have the meetings, that we could do it in between the Mondays? I mean, I don't know if
the only meeting right now where we July 9th is the only day right now where there is not anything scheduled prior to a commission meeting. So if we needed to do something, you know, on that day, we could.
No, I think she was talking about the Mondays we don't have a meeting.
Like July 2nd or July 16th? You know, the alternate Monday.
I don't have a problem with going to the 16th for the workshop, if that's good with Kristen.
Whatever we need to do, that's fine.
Okay, so we want to
That shouldn't push you to too much, would it? To move
Well, the push is the departments are going to have to get stuff done earlier. So, but as far as me, that's fine. So July 16th?
Yes.
Okay. And then there's another one for the enterprise funds on August the 13th. So what's the Monday before that would be?
That would be August 6th, unless doing something on July 30th, which they would give them an extra week, because that's where we actually end up with 2 weeks between meetings because of the way that the weeks fall. So actually, July 30th and August 6th, we do not have anything planned because you the way that our Mondays fall.
So either one of those.
Anyone have a preference?
The only suggestion might be if you did July 30th, if there was still problems with any of the funds, then we could default into the August 6th meeting and still meet our trim compliances.
Okay. I'm good with that. Are y'all good with that? Are you good with that?
Okay.
Commissioner Tucker, are you okay with that?
As long as it's not a Wednesday.
It's a Monday.
Okay, we can do that.
Okay, are you good with that? All right, we're good with it.
Anything else? Thank you.
Thank you, Stella. H4 is approval of an FPNL LED light conversion.
Harry Matrano, Public Works Director. About a year ago, Dan, when he was here, tasked me to look at some ways to do LED lighting. And in the process, we found that, well, Dan actually found that the FPNL had a program that they were just coming out with. It was kind of overshadowed by hurricanes, but it came back again. And the presentation that you see, not the presentation, but the agenda item that you see essentially puts LED lighting in the city but I'll go back and get it if I need it. Thank you, Crystal. The LED lighting, what this does is it allows the city to save a little bit of money, but we're able to relight the city. We'll get into the 22nd century with this program. All the lights will automatically, if they fail, they'll notify FPNL that they're empty and they're not working. We won't have to worry about residents calling in. What was selected, if you look at the middle column, is the replacement wattage for the lights. I don't know if anybody's had a chance really to notice how Palm Coast looks. They're the first in the area to get the program. And as you drive, lights turn on. They look like they're off and then they turn on. Hmm. It's an incredible program. It doesn't cost us any money out of pocket. And we get an improvement. And we have a very, very small savings. Stella was able to help me put this together. I didn't have this information. Dan had proprietary on it. Although it's not a very, very big savings, we do save some CO2s, we do save the environment a little bit, we have a very efficient system, plus the city will never look any better than it will ever look in its lifetime because of these LED lights. The other thing that's probably even more critical to the whole factor is public safety. I know Tom's waiting for me to say that, and that's true. Tom, I don't know if you have anything you want to say on that. Public safety.
No, I had gone out with Perry and Dan to ride through Palm Coast and take a look at it. It's substantial improvement compared to some of the lighting we have here in the city of Bunnell.
So to pretty much sum it up, as you can see, there's all our lighting inventory. This would also include the state roads and all the side streets. And essentially, we will look like a different city, but yet the same as our neighboring city, as opposed to driving from beautiful bright to dingy dark. we're going to look awesome. So, we're asking for your approval. If you've got any questions, please.
Do you have any questions for him about this? What's the pleasure of the board?
Madam Mayor.
Commissioner Sewell.
Move for approval of the Bunnell FPL LED light conversion.
I have a motion to approve by Commissioner Sewell. Do I have a second?
Second.
Second by Vice Mayor Rogers. Discussion by the board.
Madam Mayor.
Vice Mayor Rogers.
Now, didn't we see that presentation mm-hmm. at the last meeting? How the gentleman showed us how much lighter it was.
Yeah. Yep.
I thought so.
All right. Any other comments?
Madam Mayor.
Commissioner Tucker.
Let me say that we had a couple of three quotes on the relighting the football field, which in the long run would save us tons of money. So perhaps we could get the name of the guy who was talking with the former city manager and see, you know, about bringing that, you know, resurrecting that idea. Because I ride past that field and see lights on, you know, on a regular basis in the wintertime at least, and maybe not in the summertime, but
if I may.
We can
sure.
do that.
Yeah, so we did look at that a bit. And the situation with that is that we just don't use the lights enough. So the cost of converting it to the LED, at this point, it's so expensive. However, if we were, and we're trying desperately to improve the fields and get the grass looking better, get the fields more user-friendly, we might invite enough other business in to light the fields daily. That would pay the difference on what it cost us to do it. Because we have such a short window and a short period of time, it just doesn't flip into the cause. You know, Dan would spend a lot of time analyzing things sometimes, but in that case, we did look at it a little bit, and we do realize that. That's
well, we need to improve the field before we turn on better lights. You know?
Well, not even so much that. We hope to invite
just
more people.
Just kidding.
You know? I mean, invite more people in to get that field and light that field up and use it more often. And we could, you know, potentially pay for those lights. But you're right. But what I'll do is I'll try to get you the information you're looking for. I have it already.
Okay. Thanks.
Any other comments by the board? If not, I close our comments. Open for public comments. Seeing no one come forward, I close public comments. All those in favor of the motion to approve the Bunnell FPL LED light conversion signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Those opposed, motion carries.
Thank you.
Thank you. Request approval of the Sun State Meter sole source purchase of mobile data collection system. This is the other part of that.
That's the other. Good evening. This is the companion item to the presentation that you had earlier. So in October 2017, the commission approved us to start converting the utility meters to remote read capability. The project also include a fixed network or tower read system. The system had a lot of advantages and cost savings in the meter reading function, customer service function, operations functions, and revenue protection from water theft. In addition, the system would drastically shorten the billing cycle with one of the goals being to reduce potential bad debt. The system offers a continuous read capability. So in other words, it polls the meters every so many seconds. The cost of that system was $47,400, with the additional towers that had to be erected, another $160,000. So in excess of $200,000 for that entire system. We've met with Sun State now, who has offered us this other option of this vehicle-mounted system. It, of course, it's not going to be continuous polling like the towers would be, but quite truthfully, the data that we would collect that often would only be for using for customers, for maybe contacting them if we saw a high read or somebody was disputing something. We can still accomplish that, but not at the high cost, but we can accomplish it by using the mobile data collectors. And what Mr. Kimbrough suggested was maybe once a week or twice a week, we could have our meter reader, when she's riding around doing other stuff, it would still collect the data. It wouldn't be used for billing, but it could still flag us in the system if we noted somebody had a leak or some other kind of problem without going to the full-blown, every so many second reading system. So the quote for this option for two data collectors, as we talked about earlier, is $19,600. So the system itself, it's over a $27,000 savings. And then with the towers not having to be constructed, it's another $160,000. So $187,000 savings.
That's amazing.
It is.
Wow. So, what is the pleasure of the board regarding the Sun State Meter sole source purchase of the mobile data collection system?
Madam Mayor.
Commissioner Tucker.
I move we approve the Sun State Meter sole source purchase of mobile data collection system.
I have a motion to approve by Commissioner Tucker. Do I have a second?
Second.
Second by Commissioner Sewell. Discussion by the board. Hearing none, I close our discussion. Open for public discussion. Seeing no one come forward, I close public discussion. All those in favor of the motion to approve signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
Those opposed, motion carries. This is just incredible to me.
Yes.
H6, discussion city manager applications and interviews. So the city manager advertising has ended. We have 18 applications.
Yes, ma'am.
Thank you, Kristen. So the question now is, how do you want to process these 18 applications and moving forward to interviews? You have something you want to say about that?
I was told that I'm to take the lead on this, but honestly,
you go right ahead. Sorry.
Y'all only truly hire two people in the city, and y'all need to figure out how you want to do it. I don't think that staff or the city attorney should put, you know, restrictions on you. Obviously, you've got to comply with the Sunshine Law, that sort of thing that you're very familiar with already. But whatever processes you think will work, I think that's what you need to do.
All right. Tom, you have a thought there?
No, I'm in agreement.
Okay.
I have my own thoughts, but
okay.
It's your call.
Commissioner Baxley.
Yeah, I believe it or not, I spent the whole day going over all 18 of them.
Why would I not believe that?
But and I put them, you know, some of them. And there's Kristen told me, or someone told me, that there was only one person in there that did not meet the qualifications. Unless I misread it somewhere, I found four or five that didn't meet the qualifications. So
the question is how do you want to proceed?
I was coming to that.
Okay, sorry.
What I was thinking to do is I would like to see the staff just go ahead and take the ones that don't qualify, let's throw them out. Unless y'all, you know, but again, there is one thing that I do believe in. There was one that had like 19 years city commissioner experience as being a city commissioner. I mean, a city
manager.
But he didn't quite have the education requirements. Sometimes that experience, in my opinion, will override the education experience. But I'm just, again, one out of five. But what I would recommend or like to see us do is each one of us maybe pick five or six, put them together, and then the ones that are matching, the five that gets the most numbers would be the five that we would interview, or 10, or however many you want to interview.
Madam Mayor.
Commissioner Sewell.
I kind of considered something like that too, like making a point system and all, but at a minimum, I think that every commissioner here should have the right to have an interview for the person that they think is the strongest one. And that being said, that would give us five already. You know, if we each are, well, assuming that we all had five different ones, that would give us at least five. So I think we should pick at least five for interviews, but if if different commissioners have different choices, then that would solve it right there.
Madam Mayor.
Vice Mayor Rogers.
Yeah, I agree too. I think that we should all be entitled to an interview.
So you're wanting to pick one to interview?
One or two, you know, each commissioner. We can discuss that right now. Yeah, minimum of one. Absolutely.
You have any thoughts over there?
Well, I have a thought, but it more has to do with hunger.
Hunger, I understand that thought. Commissioner Tucker.
At least one, and maybe two. Yeah, our two top picks probably would be what I would do.
I was thinking that as well, because you're going to have overlap, hopefully. I mean, I can't imagine that each one of us would come to the table with two different applicants over five.
Right.
But if it does, if that's what we want to do, I'm game.
Okay.
So what we're saying is we're just going to pick one per commissioner?
Two.
Per commissioner?
Two.
Then what if that two is if four of us pick the same two?
We're on the right track.
Yep. Then we have cut our work down significantly.
What did I do?
Now, we're going from 18 to 2, potentially.
Right.
So that's a huge cut.
I've got my two.
You got your two.
Well, we would have at least, if we had differing opinions, we would have at least five interviews. But no less than two, but at least five.
Correct.
All right. Just want to make sure y'all are...
When do you want to have them done by?
Fast.
Was it closed? Is it already
closed? It's closed. It closed May 20th.
Okay.
So when is our next open session? Do we have an open...
Do you want to run down your schedule right now?
Sure.
Okay, June 11th at 6 p.m., you have the Solid Waste and Engineering Department presentations followed by a City Commission meeting. June 25th at 6 p.m., you have the Finance Department workshop followed by a regular City Commission meeting.
Okay, you can stop right there. All right, so I don't want to go out into July. I want to be sooner. So we can either do it before the meeting, June the 11th, or we can come together on June the 4th and have a meeting between the meetings to go through this. So, I mean, it shouldn't take very long, really, when you think about it, if we're each going to submit two.
Madam Mayor.
Commissioner Baxley.
If we took the two, each one of us took the two and
just sent it to
it
him.
In.
Yeah, that's what I was.
Yeah.
Well, what he's saying is if we each pick our two and we send it to you, then you compile the list of the two for each one of us.
And let us know if we all pick the same two, so we can just...
Then we just interview two.
Right.
Okay. Now, do you... Do you know who your two are right now? And then maybe we can...
I'm not ready for that.
You're not ready? Okay. All right. Now, the fourth is next week. Do you want to maybe try and set something for... a little bit more time so we can pull the information together for you?
Well, it shouldn't take very long to pull the information. The question is, can we start interviews next week? That's what I'm looking for. Because, I mean, I'm going to go home tonight, finish. I mean, I've got my list down to, I've got four. So I've just got to retool that a little bit. So, I mean, we've had the, and I was out of town and took mine with me. Mm-hmm. So I think we could send them to you by, you know, Wednesday, and maybe then we could actually look at setting up some interviews and getting some people in here by June the 4th to actually interview.
Madam Mayor.
Commissioner Soule.
I'll be out of town starting Thursday through June the 10th.
All right.
Could we do the interviews on June 11th?
We have a meeting at 7 on June the 11th. So
we can, if we want to, we can bump the department presentation again.
Which one is that?
It's Solid Waste in the Engineering Department, and try and move that to a different day. I mean, we already have the information prepared for you. It's ready to go. But if we need to move that workshop again, if you want to meet long on the 25th, we can squeeze in three department presentations and maybe try and start like a half an hour earlier on the 25th, like maybe 5:30 instead of 6, and get those three department presentations out of the way.
I don't want to be here all night either, but trying to get all the department presentations into, or picking another day, like I said, picking a day, another day other than the 11th, maybe do it on the 12th, which is the Tuesday between the code board meeting and the city commission meeting, and then you can do a special meeting on the 12th.
For interviews, is that what you're talking about?
I would.
This is June the 12th?
Yes.
Yes, sir.
Yes. Madam Mayor?
Vice Mayor Rogers?
Is the agenda, the first meeting in June, is the agenda?
The cutoff for the agenda is this Friday.
Is there a lot of stuff on there?
So we finalize the agenda at 4 p.m. on Friday for June, for the June 11th meeting.
Is there a lot of stuff on there so far?
Right now, we have two or three items, but departments haven't started inputting for that agenda because they just finished preparing for this meeting.
Okay. You know, so what we're saying is we can have the information to Kristen by June the 4th, okay? And then,
put it on the commission agenda?
Well, that's tomorrow. Wednesday's actually tomorrow. Let's say the 31st, which is Thursday. I'm thinking it's Monday.
Okay.
Yeah, it's Tuesday today.
So we'll have it by the 31st, and that way you can send out to us what that looks like.
Okay.
And then do y'all want to try, I would really prefer to do interviews not the same night as a meeting, because you don't know how long the interviews last. And I don't want to cut it short to the point that you're rushing through it and you really don't get a feel for who this is. This is really important.
So the 12th, we can have our night of interviews.
Are you good with the 12th? That's a Tuesday.
The 12th to have the interviews?
To have,
yeah.
To try to set up maybe two or three interviews that night.
Yeah, that'd be okay.
Be okay. All right, so let's shoot for the 12th.
What time would you like to start that meeting?
6 o'clock. 6:30?
No, 6.
So once we get all of the names from you, how long do you want us to schedule for them if by any chance some of you pick out-of-state applicants?
So can we do a Skype interview or whatever, a Zoom meeting interview? That's the new rage at work.
Kristen's passing the mic here.
Yes, we tested it.
Yes, that's why this laptop's sitting here. We tested it last week. Skype does work. I have that as an input into our PA system so that everybody would hear what they're being said, and it's all our PA system is also wired into that laptop to hear what you're asking. So yes, the only thing we couldn't do is project their image up here without doing some rewiring.
So we won't be able to see them on the Skype?
You could see them from the laptop, and I can have another monitor over here, but I wouldn't be able to put it up on the screen.
And Skyping to do an interview is okay, right?
Sure. And actually, I don't know if you're used to doing individual interviews, because that is legal. And sometimes you get to know someone really well with an individual interview.
One-on-one.
But yeah, that takes a lot longer, though.
That's what Wade indicated. We could talk to them individually.
Sure.
You definitely can.
So do we want to do a group interview for the first round, and then if we settle on somebody for the second round, do individual interviews if y'all want to do that? Or do y'all want to do individual interviews? Or what do y'all want to do?
Well, Madam Mayor,
Commissioner.
I think we can talk to them individually, not in a group.
Mm-hmm.
So that's what I was thinking.
So not doing a group interview?
We can do a group interview, but we also have the opportunity to do one individually.
Sure.
So just one-on-one.
Right.
And that's what I
okay.
would like
it
to
It can
do.
Be either informal or formal.
Okay. All
that's
right.
That's what I was thinking. Do it by phone, for instance. If I pick somebody and we could do a group interview, I'd say you wanted to take what I've been doing, a personal interview, just call him on the phone and interview.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
You can do that.
All right. So we'll set up for a group interview on the, what's it, the 12th, the Tuesday?
6 p.m.
The group interview, and they come here, and we interview them?
If they're local enough to come here. If not, we're going to do Skype.
Okay.
Because we're not paying for people to fly from New York and Rhode Island and
no.
California and Georgia. And
is there, again, like, do you want 35, 40 minutes for that group interview, longer?
At least 35.
Or do we want to try and figure that one out? I don't want to figure out how many actual candidates there are.
We can do actual candidates, but I would think 40 minutes. What do y'all
40
think?
40 minutes.
45 max.
Well, if there's only two, an hour at the most for.
It's not going to be, not going to be too.
Yeah, definitely.
Could be five.
Yeah.
Just don't load it.
Doubt it.
Okay, so by the 31st, each of you will provide us with your top two names. Then you want staff to set up for interviews for 40 to 45 minutes on June 12th, starting at 6 p.m. And then after that, you may do individual ones.
But we do that on our own.
Okay.
So that night, you would send us out an email who the 10 or so would be?
Would we publish the names on an agenda, Becky, or tell, send them out by email that these are the,
either the emails, 10, emails are public
names,
record.
Maybe.
It would definitely be a public record,
right,
at that point. So you can put them on the agenda, or you can just email them, whatever.
Okay.
And that's a good idea, because then they'll be able to go back and look at the resumes,
right,
and everything.
Okay,
you won't get distracted by other ones.
So once we have the most likely up to 10 names, unless there's some overlap for anybody, you may have less than that, but at most we're looking at maybe 10 names that you'll be getting an email from us saying, these are the 10 names that were picked, or these were the candidates that were picked across the board.
Yep.
You'll get that information, so then you can be able to have all those resumes ready. If you want us to attach all of their information to that agenda so the public can see that too, we will. It's public record at this point in time. They submitted it to us, so it's entirely.
That's fine.
Okay.
Any other thoughts?
Looks like it's rolling along.
Yeah.
We'll have somebody hired before Palm Coast.
Well,
I'm not touching
well,
that one.
Well, one thing I will mention that I've seen in other cities, if you dawdle around, if there's a really good city manager.
They're gone.
Yeah, they're gone.
Right.
Yeah,
right.
They get snapped up.
We are not. We are moving along here. All right, sounds good. All right, reports. City clerk.
Okay, we've already gone over your schedule, but we'll reiterate it one more time. And I do have a question. The budget workshops, do you want those to start 6, 6:30 or 7, since they are on their own off night? So the July 16th and July 30th budget workshops, what time do you want those to start?
Not at 6.
6:30?
6:30. 6:30, okay.
Is that okay with you guys?
Beautiful.
Yeah.
And since there's nothing else going on that night, you'll be able to discuss as long as you need to for those budget workshops. So June 11th at 6 p.m., we have the Solid Waste Engineering Department presentation at 6, followed by the regular commission meeting. June 12th will be the interview meeting. June 25th is the Finance Department presentation, starting at 6 p.m., followed by a regular commission meeting. And you have a regular meeting on July 9th, starting at 7 p.m., and we will call you prior to all these, so you know which times you're showing up. And then getting later into that month, July 23rd, you will also have a 6 p.m. workshop for the admin department, followed by the regular city commission meeting. So we'll send you out reminders about all this, because we got a lot going on in the next couple of months with budget season, department presentations, and the interview process, but we've got a lot going on. And then also, just to keep you informed, had we received enough applications for the charter review committee, you would have seen that on the agenda tonight. We don't have enough applicants based upon our resolution. We're going to continue to push out the request for volunteers.
How many have you gotten?
We've got 3 residents, 1 business owner. We set it at a minimum of 5 with up to 7. So we need at least 1 more to come in, and we'll go back and we'll fix the resolution. I've talked with Wade about this. We'll fix the resolution as we need to change the date for the date appointed for when this is going to happen. We're still well ahead of the game than we have been in other years, because we don't have to get these referendum information the supervisor of election until January. So we're still far ahead of the game and where we are right now. And you know, sometimes it is difficult getting volunteers to do things, but we're close. We're going to push it out on, you know, Facebook, on our website, and we'll run some more ads in the paper so that we can try and get some more residents to participate in this.
Okay.
And that's it for right now.
All All right. City Attorney?
Nothing tonight.
Tom?
I just have a couple of information. Fred, our engineer's father passed, elderly father. He's 92. So I know Perry's going to get a card. We're going to send it to him. So he's out of town for the next couple of days. And the last thing I want to remind you guys is a fundraiser luncheon hosted by Utilities Department tomorrow between 12 and 2. The event is to raise money for Lauren Bourne's family. He's one of our city employees that have passed recently. So any time between 12 and 2, it's going to be right here.
Right here.
Yes, sir.
All right.
And that's it.
Okay. Commissioner Tucker?
Nothing, thank you.
Commissioner Baxley?
Yeah, just quickly, I had been thinking about this. The employees are so good at making recommendations to improve the city or improve, save money. I would like to see us do a suggestion box, and if that improvement is made and we accept it and it saves the city money, we should have some kind of award to give that person for making that suggestion in the suggestion box. But I just thought I'd run that by y'all, see if you thought that was a good idea.
I do think that's a good idea.
I think it's a great idea. Improves their morale.
Yeah.
Yes.
Give them a certificate to a nice restaurant or...
I think we should have another picnic, Mayor.
You want another picnic?
Yes. That was good. Nice.
So why don't y'all think about it as far as in the department head staff meeting about what would be a nice reward for something like that, and have suggestion boxes and...
Madam Mayor?
Yes.
The 4th of July is coming. Why don't we have a picnic?
We need to have a picnic, don't
yes,
we?
Yes, we need to have a picnic with the parade. We always participate in the parade in Flagler.
Some of us do.
Don't throw no shade.
All right. All right, so we'll see what we can do. All right, Commissioner Soule, is that all you had? Commissioner Baxley, sorry.
Yes, ma'am.
Commissioner Soule?
Just a couple things in regards to the upcoming budget season and millage rates and impact fees.
Can't hear you.
Sorry. Just wanted to briefly mention, the upcoming budget season and impact fees and stuff like we were already talking about tonight. Mr. Porter was here from D.R. Horton to, mention D.R. Horton's concerns with impact fees as well. We are 3.2 mils higher than Palm Coast, and we need over, not immediately, it's going to have to be over some time, over some years, we're going to have to close that gap, because right now we're having to figure out how we can compete with Palm Coast for new development of homes and businesses. And what I would like to see over time is that we can close that gap and make them figure out how they can compete with us, because we have a lot to offer in lower development costs, particularly the ease of building permits, and people like to work with us when they find out about us. But I just want to give you this example. When you take the CDD fee in Grand Reserve, and let's just take a house that's after homestead exemption is assessed at $200,000. That CDD, not for the operations and maintenance of the neighborhood, but just for the bond money that built that neighborhood, that paid for the streets and the sewage, and that will pay for the future streets and sewage and things that go in there as well, works out to about 5.5 mils. Okay? So you add 3.2 mils and 5.5 mils, and you're at 8.7 mils higher than Palm Coast. So how are you going to compete with them other than price? And then if you go in and say, well, we're going to throw in these impact fees, we're closing that gap even more, so that it just makes it nearly impossible for them to sell homes. And we're going to go into a point where potentially where we could impact their sales enough that they don't build out the neighborhood as planned. So we need to take that into consideration. Likewise, if we were able to reduce our millage rate rapidly to close that gap, then perhaps we could take into consideration impact fees. Because when you pay, if you're paying, say, $8,000 or $10,000 in impact fee, that's a lot of years of property taxes up front, in which case that, and then future property taxes that go with it, we might be able to reduce our millage rate drastically from the very beginning over, not this year, but in maybe the next year or the year after. So it's good that we have the study, but right now it just needs to stay on the shelf. We don't need impact fees, and because impact fees assume that you have all this growth that you're trying to manage and control. We don't have growth that we're trying to manage and control. We're trying to attract growth. So let's get there first. Thank you.
That's it?
Rant over.
Oh, that's okay. Vice Mayor Rogers?
I said my piece.
All right. So I have a question about the fundraiser tomorrow. I know that I had asked if we were going to make a check to make it to the family. So how does that need to look? I know his name, last name, but do we put his first name on there or the sons or anybody?
It's just going to the family. So
Christina. Good boys.
Good evening, Christine Hancock, Human Resource Administrator. Right now we are putting to Lauren Bourne's estate.
Okay.
His sister-in-law is the one that's taking care of all that.
That's what I wanted to know. Thank you.
You're welcome.
I just want to say that I mentioned it earlier, the county had a wonderful Memorial Day service. It was a service. Singing patriotic songs and recognizing those in our midst. It's always a very sad time to hear how many folks have died over the last year that actually served our country. It was pretty amazing how many people, but weren't people that are Bunnell Roots people, but they're Flagler County people. And so I hope that you took time to think about that, and I just want to thank those of you for your service, Commissioner Tucker, and Commissioner Sewell, and anyone else for the service that you do now. Commissioner Baxley, thank you for your service. It means a lot to me as a person who has lived through a patriotic time, and now it looks like the patriotic movement is ebbing, and the message yesterday was don't let that happen, keep it strong, and keep it for our children and our grandchildren so they understand the sacrifices of what folks have been willing to do. So I just want to thank y'all. Thank you for that. I thought about it myself and wondered, could I have signed on the dotted line and given my life to Uncle Sam for 4 years? I had too much Coy Harris in me. He did it, but I couldn't. So it is what it is. Other than that, is there anything else that we needed to talk about? Any other events? I think everything's pretty good. All right. Do I have a motion to adjourn?
So moved.
I have a motion by Vice Mayor Rogers, a second by Commissioner Baxley. All those in favor of the motion signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, thank you. Have a good week. Thank you, Becky, for coming and joining us tonight.
Well, thank you for having me here.
I'm glad you're all well again. Sure. I know you were sick there for a while.
Oh, gosh. Yes. No, I've been well for a long time now.
Well, that's good. I don't think I've seen you, though. So.